Hi, welcome. Today we are going to extend our discussion of nuclear fission to the point charge distribution. So in today's lecture, we are going to discuss about what is charge distribution. So in part 3, initially, we have seen these two series. So when uranium-92 is bombarded with neutron, it gets excited. After excitation, it undergoes fission to form primary fission fragments. So that niobium and antimony, these are the primary fission fragments, and we have seen that they are unstable. They are unstable, therefore they undergo successive beta minus emission to give us stable nuclides. So we have seen this in part 3. Now we have to correlate it with the charge distribution. So what is in charge distribution? So each isobaric series has only one stable nuclide of atomic number, say ZS. So see, in this example, this is an isobaric series. Similarly, this is also an isobaric series. So that isobaric series has only one stable nuclide. So we have seen that niobium is unstable, therefore it undergoes successive beta minus emission to give stable ruthenium. So in this series, there is only one stable nuclide, that is ruthenium, and in this series, there is only one stable nuclide, that is cesium. So each isobaric series has only one stable nuclide. Then Z1 and Z2 are the chain enders of successive beta minus decays. So that ruthenium, we call it as Z1 and cesium as Z2. Why? Because they are chain enders. So Z1 and Z2 are the chain enders, because a chain get end here. Therefore, they are the chain enders of successive beta minus decays. Now, next point is Z10 and Z20 are the most probable charges of the primary fission fragments. So in this example, see that niobium and antimony, they are the primary fission fragments, and we have said that Z10 is the probable charge of primary fission fragment niobium, and Z20 is the probable charge of the fission fragment antimony. So for ruthenium, we have designated it as a Z1, and for cesium, Z2, for niobium, Z10, and for antimony, Z20. Now next point, see, primary fission fragments have very short half-lives. Again, see, when we consider this series, the half-life period of niobium and antimony is very small when we compare it with the molybdenum, technetium and ruthenium. So successively there is increase in half-life period in both series. So niobium and antimony, which are primary fission fragments, they have very short half-lives. Therefore, their charges cannot be observed directly. So as I have said, niobium have charge Z10 and antimony have charge Z20. But as their half-lives are very short, therefore we cannot determine their charge directly. So primary fission fragment have very short half-lives, therefore their charges cannot be observed directly, and we have to determine their charges. Now we want to determine their charges. So the most probable values of Z10 and Z20 are deduced or determined by assuming the theory of equal charge displacement. As we cannot determine or deduce their charge directly, we have to assume the theory of equal charge displacement. So by which way we can deduce the value of Z10 and Z20. So it is by the theory of equal charge displacement. Now what is this theory? So this theory implies that Z10 and Z20 will be equidistant. This word is important. They are equidistant from their final stable values Z1 and Z2 for the given isobaric series A1 and A2. So again, we consider this diagram. So that Z10 is equidistant from Z1 and Z20 is equidistant from Z2. So that theory of equal charge displacement implies that Z10 and Z20 will be equidistant from their final stable values Z1 and Z2 for the given isobaric series A1 and A2. So in other words, we can write, as they are equidistant, we can write Z1 minus Z10 is equal to Z2 minus Z20. How it comes? It comes as because they are equidistant. Therefore, we can write Z1 minus Z10 is equal to Z2 minus Z20. Now, we have second equation that Z10 plus Z20 is equal to ZF. So it is the charge of the parent fissioning nucleus. For example, in this case, we have considered uranium 92-235. In this case, that ZF is 92. So when we consider charge of primary fission fragment 1 and add it with the charge of primary fission fragment 2, their sum gives us the charge of the parent fissioning nucleus. Okay, so we have these two equations. Now, by using these two equations, equation 1 and equation 2, by doing simple mathematics with them, we can arrive at Z10 is equal to 1/2 into ZA plus Z1 minus Z2, and Z20 is equal to 1/2 into ZA plus Z2 minus Z1. So we can get value of Z10 and value of Z20, that is the probable charge of primary fission fragment first and probable charge of primary fission fragment second. So as we have said earlier, that their half-lives are very shorter, therefore we cannot determine their charges directly. We have to do some calculations. So by calculating or by using these two equations, equation 1 and 2, by doing simple mathematics on them, we can simplify equation 2 for Z10 and Z20. So this is about the charge distribution. Okay, thank you.